From across the globe. From the centre of aerospace. And now to you.
Thank you for downloading the Aero Society podcast from the Royal Aeronautical Society.
So, ladies and gents, thank you very much for allowing me to crash the party here. It's my great pleasure to introduce Oliver this evening and really to commend the Heathrow branch for picking such an inspirational topic and speaker to deliver tonight's lecture. we'll tell you a little bit about the School's Build a Plane Challenge, and I'm sure Oliver will fill in a little bit more detail, but just in terms of its importance to the society and I believe to the whole of our community. So the School's Build a Plane Challenge is really, describe it as having been our the Royal Aeronautical Society's flagship outreach project, and we think it's a model for engaging young people in this fantastic industry that we're all in. So the challenge was launched by the Royal Aeronautical Society and Boeing with support from the Light Aircraft Association in 2008. And the first two builds began a year later, led by Yateley School, very close to where I used to be at Farnborough, and Marling School in Stroud. And subsequent years, four more schools were selected to lead on a project. Bridge Learning Campus, Hartcliffe near Bristol, Erkall Wood Technology College in Shropshire, Ernestford Grange Community Academy in Coventry, and North East Wolverhampton Academy. So that's six aircraft projects in total. The great thing is that some of these schools are located in relatively disadvantaged areas, and it's been a particularly rewarding aspect of the program to see how aerospace has helped be a catalyst, really, to raise the aspirations and the skills of these young people, some of whom got very challenged backgrounds. So STEM is obviously at the heart of the program, but the great thing about SBAP is that working on a real aircraft with a prospect of flying it once it's received its permit means that pupils are introduced to the wider and very important aspects of aviation, such as airworthiness, human factors, and safety. So, for example, learning about the significance of an honesty culture. And these are all skills which can be transferred to other aspects of their lives. The great thing about aerospace and aviation, it isn't an environment just for engineers. It captures all aspects of life and business, and all the more fascinating for all of that. So in addition, and tonight Oliver is one of these occasions, the pupils were involved in the wider public engagement program, taking their aircraft to air shows, exhibitions, conferences, and riding the huge public interest which was generated by the projects, which hopefully has helped them to become more confident and outgoing. But I'm sure we'll wish Oliver the best in addressing a group of eminent individuals as yourselves. So this has lent a great sense of pride to the teams who've worked on the programs. So far, we've had three projects completed and aircraft sold on to third parties. So this is another of the program's goals has been to demonstrate that the youngsters could deliver these projects to saleable standards. One of the great things about it is that a number of the potential buyers have come forward having seen the aircraft flying and being impressed with the quality of the aircraft. We've got some history made here. So YTLY and SBAP, the dual air display at Farnborough in 2014 was the first of its kind, and GWFT was the first school-built aircraft to fly at Cosford. So let's come back to the society. So the promotion and facilitation of this challenge really, for me, captures the essence of what the Royal Aeronautical Society is all about. So those who see us as simply a collection of grey heads stuck away in a nice old building just off Piccadilly, we really need to wind the clock back 150 years to when the society was founded. And it was founded by a disparate group of enthusiasts, no more than that. And they were frustrated enthusiasts. They just felt that there was a bit more that could be done in the way of science and art in aeronautics rather than simply ballooning. And really today we're just trying to do the same thing. We're trying to let people who are frustrated, who want to change, who want things to develop, to have a voice and get on and do this. But of course the environment has changed. You know, today's industry, which didn't exist 150 years ago, is very mature. And many of you work in an industry which brings together mind-bogglingly large numbers of people. It transformed global commerce. And of course, it's continuously resetting the benchmark for reliability and safety. So the environment's changed enormously, but societies like ours can still create waves and engineer change. So during my year as president of the society, I'm trying to push a very simple set of messages to define what we're about. We're about peer-to-peer activity. We're about honing knowledge and ensuring continuity of expertise. We're about developing and maintaining standards. We're also about inspiring new ideas and inspiring new people. And all of this needs to be facilitated by a strong sense of community. The peer-to-peer bit, which I mentioned at the up front, is very important. Learned societies are not service providers, okay? We depend on active participation by our members, both individual and corporate, which is why activities such as the Heathrow branch are so very important to the society, and I'd commend you all to continue your support for the branch. So this community and all these things we do, it's actually a magic recipe, because it's worked for six generations of the aeronautics community, and it will work perfectly well in the future, provided we package it up in the appropriate way. So Schools Build a Plane is a model for what we do, because everyone involved, not just the school pupils, gained knowledge and experience about light aircraft construction, test, flight trials, and indeed sales. Because it gave participants a clear view on the importance of standards and quality, and because it relied on a community of benefactors and volunteers really connected only by their passion for aerospace and for aviation. So before I introduce Oliver, just a word of thanks, because none of this project could have been achieved without the support of Boeing, the Light Aircraft Association, the teachers and the schools involved, and in particular, the volunteers, many of whom were Royal Aeronautical Society branch members who worked tirelessly on the project, including some very cold winter months in unheated hangars, perhaps even in the sleet and snow we've got tonight. So they did this to mentor the pupils and support the wider public engagement activities. And this volunteer support has had a lasting impact on the schools, many of whom are already planning further STEM projects to follow on from this exercise. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Oliver Vass to come and give his perspective on the program and hopefully to answer some probing questions from you guys this evening.
Fantastic, thank you. So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd first like to thank you for trekking through the Arctic conditions outside. It's not the best conditions to come from, but thank you very much for all turning up. So my name is Oliver Vass, I'm 20 years of age, and I'd like to kind of take you on a journey, the same journey that I've been on with my other colleagues and the mentors, and some of them are here today, so I'd like to also thank them for coming. I'll touch base with them later in the presentation. But before I start, I would just like you to have in the back of your mind this quote, and I'll touch base with this later, but so what is a career path? So a career path is the route that individuals take from their first venture into the job market through to their final position before retirement. So I'd just like you to have that in the back of your mind, and I'll touch base on that later. The second one is, what is success? So I Googled this, this quote, but actually it works quite well, and I'll also come back to this later on. So Google says that success is the achievement of something desired, planned, or attempted. So just an overview of the lecture today, what I'm just about to present. So I'll run over a quick introduction, I will then touch base on the school's build a plane project quickly. How did I get involved in the project? The build process, so I'll take you through not the nitty-gritty bits, but just my experience of building an actual real-life aircraft. The challenges overcome. Every challenge that you go through has to have challenges worked around and solutions to it. Events that I got involved in, flying opportunities, work experience, what being part of this project has meant to me, why young people should get involved in the aviation industry, and thank you for coming, guys. And then my future career. So just a brief introduction about myself. So I went to Yateley School and studied GCSEs. I got 14 GCSEs, a mixture of subjects. I then stayed at Yateley School, sixth form, and studied English literature, geography, graphics, and economics. I then went to Surrey University and studied business management. And I'm now currently on my placement year at BMW UK in the head office with a modern retailing team, which delivers innovative products to the UK market. So I'm actually delivering an app at the moment, which is the first of its kind in the automotive industry. And I'm project managing that. So I'll touch base on how this project has helped me in my gap year, or I say my year in industry. Outside of all this, I enjoy target rifle shooting, which I know is a different sport to football or rugby. And also leading on from this, I do target sprint. So it's a new kind of combining running and shooting. I'm also very keen in the gym. Just touch base on a few things. So as I mentioned, this is a photo that was taken by my university. And this is just sports, my sport, rifle shooting. This is my coach. So she's a Paralympian. She's won eight Paralympic medals, 5 golds, 4 silvers, and 2 bronzes, I believe. And she's been there throughout my shooting career over the last 6 or 7 years, behind me at every single international competition that I go to. So I would like to kind of put the two together of how this project has also helped me with outside sports. One of my main successes is achieving some international medals at competitions, and that was a fantastic opportunity. And I've done this alongside of working with the engineers and building this plane. So just a quick introduction to the build a plane. I'm gonna whistle all the while, if that's what it takes to make me smile. I'm gonna walk 100 miles. I'm gonna run right up this hill. Summer sky or winter chill. If I gotta take a break, I will. But I'm gonna run right up this hill. I wanna hold the whole wide world right here in my open hands. And maybe I'm just a little girl with great big plans.
The Royal Aeronautical Society has been involved in educational programs for many years. This particular program, we have been working very closely in conjunction with Boeing. This is one of the most exciting programs I've been involved in my career in aerospace. The enthusiasm of the youngsters involved has really been quite infectious. They're able to get actively involved in building something that they will eventually fly in. But more importantly, it helps them much better understand all of the aspects of STEM, science, technology, engineering and maths involved.
Boeing supports the School's Build a Plane Challenge because we believe it's important to inspire people into engineering and sciences.
Such a fantastic opportunity for students in our school to be involved in a project such as this.
So much of what goes on in the classroom kids can't relate to. So if they can actually see what it can lead to, then that really inspires them.
All of our students have done work on flight in their design technology courses.
There's been a tangible difference in attitude. You have got kids engaged, you've got kids trying to move into better groups, you've got kids suddenly desperate to get GCSEs in maths because they can see what it can relate to.
It's also improved their relationship with teachers, with myself. It's improved their motivation and their their work ethic, and they, at the end of the day, that's going to make them better pupils. They're going to achieve better grades.
Over there, I guess we've already got a couple of guys who could easily be airframe fitters. They're that good after 1 year.
There's been a lot of enthusiasm from the kids, and it's been brilliant.
Yeah, I heard about it, and then like me and my mates ran about all doing it.
We thought this would be a good challenge.
I think it would be a real shame to know that this project happened in my school and I didn't take part in it.
They're really quite surprised that the school's building the plane.
It's something that gave me skill, it gave me confidence.
It's just fun.
I think it's such a huge sense of achievement as well, like it's the sort of thing that most people don't even think about doing, you know.
Yeah, I remember with one of my interviews at the universities, I couldn't believe we were building a plane. They thought it was one of those toy ones. They said, what, like this big? And I said, no, that's why this room.
So getting the kit now is a big exciting thing, and then getting the kids to see how you're going to turn that box of raw materials into something that will take off.
So just to summarise all of that video in one, so this is a diagram that I created a few weeks ago, actually. And it basically, in 2009, so Boeing and the Royal Aeronautical Society joined with the help of the Light Aircraft Association to create this fantastic project, the Schools Build a Plane project. So the plane, so what is this plane? So it's a kit plane. It's a microlight light aircraft with a Jabiru engine, so it's got around 80 horsepower, which is less than my car, actually, so it's crazy to think that this actually takes off. Maximum speed of 110 miles an hour, and maximum weight of 450. So what are the aims of the project? So the aims are to motivate, encourage, enhance, and inspire. So motivate. So motivate people in areas of science, technology, engineering and maths. This is also known as STEM. Encourage people's awareness of the aviation industry. People my age don't really know what's out there and what they want to do. Some people don't even know what they want to do tomorrow. So it's a way of getting people to know what is out there and the opportunities that are available to them. Enhance the Royal Aeronautical Society's and Boeing's links with the local community. And inspire. So inspire teachers and promote interest in STEM subjects. So there, as mentioned earlier, there are six projects: Yateley School, Marlin School, Bridge Learning Campus, Erklewood School, Northeast Wolverhampton Academy, and Ellsford Grange Community School, if that's how you pronounce it. So three of them have been sold, and the money was reinvested into this project so more young people like myself can take part in it. So Yateley School is just here, and it's in Hampshire. So in 2009, Yateley School was awarded this fantastic project, and it joined with other two schools, King's College and Courtmore School. So what is aviation for me? So as you can see from the photo, that's me as a kid in an aircraft. And never did I know that I would be sat next to the pilot, John Mitchie, and actually flying a real-life aircraft. Now that is... it's something that is incredible, and never knew that I could manage to do that. So how did I get involved in this project? How did it come about for me? So I was sat in science class one day, and my science teacher, Miss Utley, she walks in the room and she said, right, guys, who wants to build a plane? So we looked at each other all baffled, like, well, what's she going on about? So we all looked at each other and thought that it was just to build a small model aircraft. No one knew that this was going to be a real plane. And then she said, no, we're going to build a real-life two-seater aircraft. So then I immediately stuck my hand up. Of course you would, wouldn't you, to get involved in something as extraordinary as this. So that's where it began. So I stuck my hand up and I've been involved ever since. That was how many years ago now? 8 years ago. So it's been part of my life for 8 years. So the start. So how did it all start? So we were shown a plane in our school playground, and this was the same Rounds Coyote plane. And this inspired us to what we should aim for. This is what, you know, the kids at school should aim to do. Also, Stuart Luck. We got to meet Stuart Luck, who also built the same kind of plane with the Air Scouts. So we were showing what success looked like as such, and this is what we all desired to do. The local community were also involved in this, so it was a chance for the local community to come and support the school in what they were doing. So just a brief timeline. So in 2009, Yankee School received the opportunity to do this, and the build took until about 2012, so about 3 years. At 2012, we displayed the Farnborough Air Show, and in 2013, it had its first public flight, flown by the pilot, John Mitchie. So the build process. So where do we start? So one day at school, in the summer holidays in 2009, all these bits arrived in boxes. And we thought, God, where do we start? So this is two of our supervisors just trying to work out what we do with this. Where do we start? And we got a manual. We had the manual. It's a good, thick manual. We dumped it on the desk and we're like, right, how are we going to do this? So this is us really early on in the stage. And as you can see, there's a photo of me there riveting. So I'm working closely with John there and another one of my friends, who I'm really good friends of now, fixing the rudder. So this is where we started. We started in a small technology classroom, started on the small parts. We then worked on the fin, on the tail fin. So this is a group photo of us. So I like to take photos as we go along just to kind of track our progress, really, and just to show how we came together as a team to do this. So just a small clip from Meridian News.
As projects go, this one is definitely for the high flyers. 100 pupils at a Hampshire school have been set the challenge to build, in just 12 months, their very own flat-pack plane. And yes, it is a real plane. The plan, concocted by staff and pupils at Yateley School, is to fly it at next summer's Farnborough Air Show. At the moment, it doesn't look like very much. Just a collection of metal poles in packaging, bolts in boxes, and a whole range of things that are hardly even identifiable. But in just a year's time, this giant Meccano set will hopefully look like this. And this cockpit, these fuel tanks, and this part of the tail fin will all be hundreds of feet up in the air above Hampshire.
Farnborough Show next year, 2010, that is our actual goal, and we're determined to get there, and I'm sure we will.
The rough guide is that 600 hours need to be put in to get the plane built, but obviously with a school full of children, it's going to be a lot harder to manage 600 hours. Probably going to be more like 1,000 for us, but it's going to be good. We're going to get it done by Farnborough Show. Absolutely determined. If we have to work through the night, we will.
For now, though, all the carefully labelled parts have to be marked off to make sure they're all here. And as each section is put together, it's rigorously checked by several people. The project, run by the Royal Aeronautical Society and Boeing, will see the students selling off the plane after the air show, so they're already planning a website to drum up interest.
There's young people at school getting introduced to one of Britain's most successful industries. To see the sense of excitement on the faces of these young people as they're beavering away, assembling their aeroplane, is very exciting.
But with just 12 months until takeoff, the teenagers will have to work hard to get their idea off the ground. And no doubt they'll do it. We'll of course keep you updated on their progress.
So we're very lucky to have Meridian News actually follow us throughout the build. And it's incredible to be able to get the opportunity to be presented on the news. So I remember sat down one evening and got all my family around the telly and we all sat there and watched it. And that was the first time there was a small clip that I was actually on the news. And the sense of achievement just being shown on TV was actually incredible. And this project allowed me to do that. So moving on in the build. So we then moved from our small technology classroom because of the space, and we actually moved into the shed. So it was a small shed in the on the school campus, so we kind of moved in there and all went in there. And it was very bare, just brick walls and a few tables. So as you can see in the photo above, we've got the mainframe, and then we're just working on the wheels. So we're using all the bits that we can around us to build this plane. And there's a photo of me, I believe that might be John, And we're actually trying to work on solving how to put the wheel on. So that was where we first started. And that's now a photo of the wheel being popped on there. And I say popped on, it was a harder process. And we're constantly referring back to the manual. And as the Meridian News clip said, each part that we made had to be successfully signed off for us to continue. So that was the work of our supervisors, and especially John and a guy called Gordon, who came and detailed and expected to make sure that it was perfect. So what bit do we move on to next? So we moved on to the fuselage. And every part of this we manually did. We filed, we sawed, we riveted. And we only had the tools available that were brought by the supervisors. So one of the drills you plugged in and it kind of sparked a little bit. It was all safe, don't worry. But we used tools that, you know, they had in their back garage. It was kind of just using whatever was available to help us build this plane, like I said. So there's just a few photos of just that you can kind of get a size, a feel of how small this room was. And we're trying to build this plane in this tiny shed. So just to keep my idea going of these group photos, there's a photo of us with the four supervisors in the background. We found this sign that says Build a Plane Workshop. So we popped that up in our photos just to do a little promo shoot. So like I said, Meridian News followed us throughout this build process. And I'd like to show you another clip. This is my first interview with a news, and it's quite a funny one because, like I said, this is a journey, and I've changed quite a lot since then, so spot the guy that does the most hours.
Now for a high-flying school project. Forget building bird tables in woodwork classes or making models in metalwork. A group of school children in Hampshire are building a plane from scratch which will fly at next summer's Farnborough Air Show. Nick Harper's been finding out more.
Beginning to take shape, but not quite ready to take off. But not bad considering 4 months ago it looked like this. Bits in boxes, parts still in their packaging. They have a year in total to get it looking like this and ready to fly at Farnborough Air Show.
I've done quite a bit really. I'm here every session. I've done 50 hours of constant work, so I've put quite a lot of effort into it.
It always seems so far out of reach to build a plane. Once you look at the blueprints, once you get past all the big numbers and facts and figures, it's not that hard.
It's all about organisation. The parts are carefully labelled, there's useful reminders to help them out, and a team of adults from the Light Aircraft Association to make sure everything is where it should be. There's also hundreds of pages of instructions, vital for a project this size.
It makes it easier when you can find the instructions, but at one point we lost the instructions for the firewall. We found them again.
Who would think that you could come to school and actually build a plane that is then going to be flying? And I've been so impressed with the care that they are taking. And if they want me to get up and fly in this plane, as long as somebody else pilots it, then I'm going to be very happy to do that.
The company Boeing, who are behind the project, are now trying to organise a qualification that the children would get for being involved in the build.
Inspiring children at a very young age for careers in aviation, whatever that might be pilots, might be engineers, it might be maintainers, and so on. We think that's a very important thing to do.
So not long before this workshop creation is taken to the skies over Hampshire. Nick Harper in Yateley for Meridian News.
So that was my claim to fame. As I said, I showed that to all my friends and posted it on Facebook and Twitter. And I was like, guys, check me out. I look back on that, I think, oh, what was I doing then? But that's all part of what this project is growing and developing as a person. So I'd like to talk a bit about roles and responsibilities. So it wasn't just the engineering side of it. It was also the marketing, the PR, and the communications aspect. So this sketch was a sketch of one of the girls, not one of the girls, I say that, that's me in that sketch. One of the girls that was in our team, she liked artwork, and she said she wasn't interested in the engineering side, but she wanted to get involved in the aviation industry, in the marketing side of it. So we thought, great, you know, come on board with us. So we ended up using her and to help write our reports and things. And this is the sketch she did just to promote the build throughout the community. This photo here shows us putting the floorboard in. So it wasn't just, here you are, this is all ready, and just pop it in. We actually had to sand it down using machines, hand file it, and then hand paint it, and do all the finishes with it and put it in. And this is all following the manual, don't worry. So the next bit was putting the controls in. So as you can see, the floorboard's in and the rudder pedals are in. Now these controls are fly-by-wire. So you had tiny pulley systems that go all around the plane. And my first reaction was, how's a bit of string gonna move the wing? And how is this plane gonna fly just on wire? And it was a crazy thought to have. Now, you may be thinking, did we actually do this by ourselves? Or did the supervisors just step in and we've taken all the fame and glory from it? But I'd like to put that thought to rest, and I'll show you a video of myself working on and my colleague working on the firewall. So this is when we came to put the firewall in. So this bit of steel will prevent any damage coming in to the cockpit. But yeah, please have a look at this video.
The date is the 8th of March 2010. Me and Chris are riveting the firewall.
So we did actually have a supervisor there watching us, but that's one of the tools that we had. So we started with a hand rivet, and these rivets attached two bits of metal together. So we had this hand rivet, but we couldn't actually get it closed because it was extremely hard, especially when you went up a rivet size. So we then borrowed this extremely good rivet gun, and all you had to do is just squeeze it in. But that video shows the actual hands-on process of building this plane. So it wasn't just the supervisors doing it. It was us actually hands-on doing it, which was fantastic. So as we move on, I've said that we had two partner schools that built the wings, so the two wings were built at two separate schools. This is one of the schools working on the wings. These wings were then transported to the home hub as such, Yateley School, and we assembled them in our shed as such, that's what I call it. This is a photo of me with one of our supervisors, Mike Clues. And we're just working on the engine, getting it perfect. Once the wings were in the shed, as I like to call it, we attached them. So there's a photo of me and John working together on the wings. So that was a very, very scruffy outfit. I don't agree with that, but never mind. It was after school as such. So this is, you can kind of see the space that we had. So these, we had to turn the plane at really weird angles just to get these huge, gigantic wings in. And that was quite an incredible achievement, actually, just to get both wings on in this tiny area. So the last photo I'd like to show you, the build process, is putting the fabric on the outside. So basically what it was is this bit of fabric. It was all safe and things, but this fabric went round and you tied it all up. So it was just like wrapping it up for Christmas. And we chose some fantastic colours there, yellow and pink, so it really did stand out. And then the other next bit is putting the wing shield on. So during the build process, we got to demonstrate the plane in a number of different locations. And one of my favourite was actually in the Science Museum. So we're there right in the middle of the Science Museum displaying our plane. So there we are in all our branded T-shirts. We got these T-shirts done that said our names and who sponsors us as well. So we're there showing us some great support. So a fantastic bit about this is that we got to meet some World War II veterans. So hearing their stories, laughing, saying, I wouldn't get in that plane, not built by a proper person. Saying, sure, it was built by me. You sure don't want to go for a fly? So. Yeah, it's fantastic to meet them and them to have the expressions on their face, I think, just really sums it up. The two guys are laughing away there, and the other guy's kind of quizzing me while I'm posing for this photo. So I would like to talk a bit about the supervisors and kind of how we worked to get this done, and what was the structure, or if there was any structure. So let me just pull these photos up. So what we did is we kind of we would have these build sessions. So we'd have three sessions a week, roughly around there, so about 2 hours each, and we would split up into smaller teams. So there'd be two students to one supervisor, and that worked really well. So these photos show me and my friend, actually really good friends now, Grace, and here's us taking in turns to actually build the part of the plane, and this is the support bits in the fuselage. So it just shows the connection that we had with the supervisors. They would be there telling us how to do it and watching us, and this worked really well because it was still a proper hands-on approach. So the next bit is just to highlight that fact. So here's a supervisor, one of our supervisors, Mike Clues, and as well as saying, back in my day when we did it this way and how we would do it, it was great hearing all these stories about what they did. So Mike Clues, I remember saying he was telling about his days when he was younger, and he was actually a BA pilot for a commercial plane, so he was telling us how he flew all these planes, and it was incredible to hear these stories hands-on while building an actual plane to ourselves, and it was them stories that I'll never forget. So here, one of the supervisor, Mike Clues, like I said, is showing us how he would do it and showing us what the best practice way is. And then here's one of our students, one of the people in my team, James. He's actually trying it out, trying these different ways. And what this leads to is a perfect manual fit. So that's just how we work together to do that. So like I mentioned in the beginning when I introduced myself, there's going to be challenges, isn't there? Of course, we're undertaking a complete build and the first in the country to do it as a school. So one of the main challenges is the build location. So I've said that the build location is a tiny, tiny shed. So what we had to do is we didn't have really many different things that would help us. So we built our own kind of like board where we could just pop the bits on and pull them off when we need to. And this is one of the ways that we overcome their challenge of space. The other one was, as the outside temperature shows, it's really cold. So we're there with our hats and gloves on in the freezing cold. And this place had no heating. So what do? We invested in a patio heater. So we all huddled under that for our kind of like half an hour breaks, as you call it. Commitment. So we had a huge issue with commitment because it's quite a big project over a long time. So we had a number of people drop out. Of course, there was the core number of people that did it, about eight of us that stuck through it the whole project. But GCSEs got in the way and exams got in the way, and of course, education had to take priority at this stage. So team, so as we were a big team, we're about 8 to 10 people, plus supervisors with their busy life, we had to get everyone together. And that proved actually very challenging. Engineering difficulties, as I touched on before, the engineering difficulties of having like just random tools to use and not the proper equipment as such. And then sign-off, so it took a long time to check each component and check that it was perfect and then get it signed off. So events, so I mentioned the Science Museum. Shuttleworth Air Show we also displayed at, Farnborough Air Show 2010, 2012 and 2014. We also had the opportunity to meet the Duke of Edinburgh, flying opportunities that we got and the Breitling Trophy we were awarded with for our final reward for it. And you say, how would we move this plane around to all these events? Now this is, at first, is we put it on the back of a trailer, so as we're driving through the local town, everyone was looking and thinking, God, what's that? What's that driving along in the back of a trailer? But that's how we did it. And then we then moved on to a van. So we put the plane in the back of a van. I just remember pulling the plane out the back of a van and assembling it so everyone could see how far we've got. And that was the best part about it. So the Breitling Awards, so we had the opportunity to go to the Royal Aeronautical Society headquarters and be presented for all our efforts with an award. And there is Prince Andrew giving an award to us. And it was great to meet a member of royalty, and not many people at my age can say that they, or when I was back then, 15, 16, can say that they met royalty, and that's fantastic. So Farnborough Air Show, so in 2010 we displayed the plane. So it was nearly built then, we just needed to put the covers on the wings and then do a bit more with the engine. However, we were in a prime location, so we went to the Futures Day on the photo on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side is us displayed right inside, and you can see the Vulcan aircraft just outside from where we were. So it was great to have such an iconic plane and the future of what the aviation industry kind of looks like and inspiring the younger generation. Then we displayed the plane at Farnborough Show 2012. And this was a fantastic opportunity. We upgraded where we were, so we had displayed the plane, and we had smoke coming underneath, so it actually looked like the plane was flying, and that got everyone's attention. And I believe his name is David Willetts, this guy, and he's the Minister of Science. And one of my friends, Grace, ran up to him and he said, David, do you mind coming and seeing around our plane? And he was actually with Airbus at the time. So we moved him from his Airbus colleagues all the way to Boeing and the Royal Aeronautical Society. So that was a great one, absolutely fantastic. And he's a very photogenic, as you can see in the photos. And then the iconic bit was the Farnborough Show in 2014. So the plane actually flew out with our twin or sister plane, the Marlin School. So we displayed it, spoke about it with the public, and then they actually got to see it flying in the air. Now, to me and my team, or say my team, but the colleagues that I was working with, this was kind of the pinnacle to fly at Farnborough Air Show, you know, one of the best air shows in the world. And to see our plane up there above the skies was, I think, one of the most satisfying and best feelings I've ever felt in the world. So I'd like to show you a quick, short video of what it was like from the pilot's view to fly this plane above this air show. So the next clip shows that.
It's really well made and it looks very good. It's like birds flying. It's amazing. It's really intriguing. I think I should take an airplane one day.
And I think this kind of work is really important for young people. And because young people is the future of our aviation industry.
I'm really proud of our school for it.
I'll tell them it's really cool. I'll also say to them that they should come here too and do something a bit like it.
This looks like being the hottest day of the year here at Farnborough. So sunscreen, hats, certainly lots of water.
And it's a groundbreaking achievement because it's the first time a plane built by students has flown at Farnborough Air Show.
Alpha Papa ready to start at Sierra 4.
Sumi Yankee Golf Alpha Papa, start is approved. Information Roman UQNH 1012.
Play to start 1012.
Rands Golf Lima Yankee, Sierra 4, enter runway 24, line up and wait. Aircraft vacate.
Rands, when ready, clear for display. Surface wind 220 degrees, 10 knots, varying between 160 and 260 degrees. Report rolling.
Build a plane, duo rolling.
We'll be right back.
was absolutely fantastic flying. Thank you very much, John. So that was us at Farnborough Air Show 2014, and that was a fantastic, fantastic opportunity, and to watch that was just emotional as such. So I'll touch on the flying opportunities that we got from this project. So the first is the LEA had a flying show, a flying day, so we could go along with our families and get the opportunity to fly in different aircraft. So this is quite a funny photo, I think, of myself. Shows how much I've changed. But this is me in a 1929 Pete and Poe air camper, and you got to put the hat on and the Biggles. You look like the guy Biggles, and you got to put the goggles on as well. And that was awesome to fly in an open pit cockpit, and just fly along was amazing in this old plane. So the next opportunity to mention there as well, they also got the parents involved. So when the parents came along, they also got to fly in the supervisor's plane. So two of our supervisors, John and Mike, they actually own their own planes and built them. So my parents got to fly in that, and they came away just like, wow, we need to get in the aviation industry. And that was quite a striking comment, actually. So the next is a gliding scholarship. So through this project, I managed to get a gliding scholarship. So this was formed by the Air League, and this is a week's gliding. So it was very intense. It was, you know, a 9-to-5. It felt like I was in a full-time job, but actually it was fantastic. And I worked with the guy that was helping me get to the end of this, and it was fantastic. So here's a few photos. So there's my instructor, and he's just got his parachute on, and he's just waving me goodbye. So he doesn't know if I'm going to come down, or he doesn't know how I'm going to do. So he's just standing there, hoping for the best. I hope he was. And this is me when I landed. So I know you can't quite clearly see my face, but the sense of achievement, and just the passion for it, and to come down, and it was just amazing. And it was a very successful flight. So at the end of this, I managed to get my glider's pilot's license, and for me this was a huge achievement to do this in a space of the week and actually take two flights solo, which I never ever had the confidence in the beginning of the week to think that I would do that, and that was extraordinary. The next opportunity that I got to do is work experience. So where was it? It was here in Heathrow Airport. And it was with the British Airways Engineering Department. So it was in July 2011 for a week. So part of school, we had to do work experience. So the thought of going into work for most people was extremely daunting, and it was for me. However, I was lucky enough through this project to land myself a place on this week's experience. So here's just a few photos of me. I should be wearing a colourful tabard. But I think I took it off just to look cool in the photos for that. I put it straight back on again, don't worry. So what did I work on? So here, I don't know exactly what part this is. Me and William, one of the guys from the Royal Aeronautical Society, tried to work out what it was, because I'd completely forgotten. But it was damaged by a bird. And I worked with the engineer there to actually piece by piece fix this, and to actually be able to work on a real, apart from a real aircraft, was such a satisfying thing to do. So what else did I do? So I climbed in the back of an engine as well to fix a fire duct, fire protector. So we climbed in the back of this and it just sat there. And there's this huge, big kind of like slide, and fantastic. Who else gets the opportunity to do that? And then, for the end of the week, the most rewarding, I think, part of this was that I got to do an engine test on a Boeing 747. So they said, right, Ollie, come up here. So he sat me in the seat, and I got to actually put the throttle all the way up. We didn't move anywhere, which was outstanding. It was incredible to think that this thrust was coming out, yet we didn't move anywhere, but obviously the chains are rattling behind us. So that was fantastic. And then I don't know if you guys remember, but in 2011, actually it's a long time ago, I don't know why I'm asking you, but there was this whole craze that went on about in social media. And there was this whole craze about planking. So it was laying down flat in the middle of random, really random places. So I took this work experience to full advantage to get the most likes on social media back then when I tried to be cool as such. And this is my idea of planking. And yeah, that racked up quite a lot of likes actually. Again, there, my highlighted tabard isn't on because I wanted to look cool in this photo. But I think I've got the goggles on, which really wasn't a cool look. We'll leave that on. So, what has being part of this project meant for me? So I've already touched on a few things, but just to put this in a, looks like a very technical diagram. Don't worry, it's just pulled off PowerPoint. But I'd like to start with the teamwork aspect of it. So working in a team as such to get this done, we worked with different people, different ages, different diversities, people from different backgrounds, and that has taught me so much. And I'm actually using the teamwork aspect that I learned in this project through to working in a corporate environment in BMW now, which is absolutely fantastic to be able to transfer these skills. So what else have I learned? Commitment and dedication. I think these are two key aspects that you need whenever applying these to your life, because they are important. Like I said, this project has gone on for 8 years. Now, I know I haven't done much in the last few years. However, over the 5 years as such of building and showing at these events, I was an extremely passionate young kid, and I like to attend every event. Now, this is quite important because this teaches you commitment and dedication. The next bit is time management. So it's managing your time around the exams that went on. So do you go to Farnborough Air Show in 2010 when you've got an exam on Monday morning? I think it was on English literature, which wasn't very interesting. But so it's just learning about time management skills and applying different skills to that. And I actually use this time management skill now. My manager said last week that to be a successful project manager, you need to write a tight brief, and have tight timelines. And all part of this is time management, you know. And in the forward corporate environment, this is extremely important. And flexible working as well. You need to balance your life with work. And the final one, I think, is confidence. Back then when I was a little kid as such, you can see in these videos that I've kind of matured and grown up as a person. And I would never, ever dreamt of having the confidence to come up here and present to you guys if it probably wasn't for this project. I've done speeches in front of a few hundred people, and to walk into an interview and say, and them ask, so what have you done with your life? I've actually built a plane and I've done a speech in front of 500 people up in London. And they look at you with just silence. And that's when you know you can walk out and know that you should be able to get a phone call within the next couple of days because of this project. So I lead on to why should young people get involved in the aviation industry. So I would like to read out a quote that Sir Michael Arthur Byrne, President of the UK and Ireland, said. So Byrne is in its 100th year of business, and in order for us to continue shaping the world of aerospace with our customers, partners, and suppliers, we need a new generation of talented engineers. He then goes on to say that to fulfill this pipeline, we need people from young schools and things to get involved in this. And it's through projects such as the Schools Build a Plane Challenge that this is made possible. So, the UK is the second largest economy in the aerospace industry. And I'd just like to point out a few facts. I pulled this off Google as well, just like my quotes. But you can see here that in 2010, so in the last 6-7 years, there's been a 40% growth. Now, when you think of that, you think, wow, that's a lot. What would that be in the next 7 years? Is that going to double? Is that going to triple? Now, if I was younger, or at the age I am now, I'd be looking at that statistic and thinking, okay, so where are these jobs going to come from? And it's going to come from an industry like this where it's booming and the growth rate is going to continue even more. I would then like to point out that there is 130,000 direct employees in this industry. So not indirect, this is completely direct employees, with a growing number of apprenticeships as well. An extreme number there of a £31 billion turnover, and that just shows the importance of the aviation industry and why young people should get involved in this. So looking into the future of my career, so I bet you all sat there wondering, why when he's built this plane is he working for BMW, an automotive industry? So why has he spent his life doing this and then worked for an automotive car company? But I think in the current generation, the world is becoming very flexible. It now gives you the opportunities to move between industries and between sectors. So you can go into university and study something, and then you can move into a completely different sector, and it's all from your experiences. Now, so one of my aims is to finish my university degree. I'm currently on placement year, so I'd like to go back to university, finish this degree in business management. But then I would like to come out of that and then combine my passion from this project with the aviation industry and business management. From going into the work experience, I realized that engineering wasn't my forte. I hadn't studied it at school, and it didn't really captivate me, yet the aviation side did. So my passion is to go into the aviation industry, but combine this with business. And I think going into the automotive industry as well has kind of helped all these skills, and it's kind of given me direction on where I want to go. I also mentioned a quote at the beginning. I said about the career path as routes that individuals take from their first venture in the job market through to their final position before retirement. Now, I work in a department where three people have just left, and their career spanned 30 years in BMW. Okay, yes, the pension pays well, but they haven't moved around. And I think that now, in modern society, we are able to move around, and just because I didn't study engineering or maths or science as such, I still believe that everyone should get involved in different industries, and it's through doing this Build a Plane project that I've realised my desire to go into the aviation industry, something that I wouldn't have explored doing before. So coming to the conclusion, to the end of my presentation, I would just like you to recall and regurgitate the quote that I said at the start, and that was success. Now, yes, okay, that was a Google definition. Okay, Google did a good job there, but it defined desired, planned, and attempted. So how does this relate to the project that we've done? So we desired, so we're shown a plane, a fully built plane, and we're shown what it should look like. We planned. So, okay, yes, organization wasn't the best of us, but we planned in a team, we worked with the supervisors, and we planned to achieve what we desired. We then went to attempt this. And to my opinion, and I would say that on behalf of all the other people that I've worked with, that this leads to the ultimate success, and is that I want to finish on. But before I finish, I'd also just like to thank the supervisors that we have worked with. Without them giving their dedicated hours and all their stories about back in my day and how we did this, and you know, without these stories and without the opportunity to do this and go to these events, I truly don't believe that I would be the person that I am now. And to say that I've just completed my first lecture will be one that I won't forget, and it will go on social media, and I'm not wearing a bright highlighted tab, which is even cooler. So I'd just like to say thank you very much for attending today and listening to my experiences, and I'd now like to take any questions. Thank you. I think we're bringing over a special microphone.
I'm going to start by saying over Christmas I was talking to Mike Clues. Mike sends his apologies. He's away at the moment, so he couldn't come.
No issues.
Mike put the word around to some of the other people that were involved with your project, and I'm hoping they're here tonight. You're 20. You show an enthusiasm that's absolutely enormous. I have a young lady next to me who's involved in Aeronautical Society branches, activities. The world needs people like you and Hania. I'm coming up to retirement. I want to see people like you and Hania running my industry in the future. I just want to say thank you. That's really all I want to say. And good night from Mike Clues, who's away.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you. Any more questions?
Oliver, Stephen here. Just want to say a huge well done. I've been through a very similar journey, but on the Olympics, I was the ambassador for the 2012 Games.
Fantastic.
Talking about the Build a Plane project, the barrier to entry for the aviation industry is very, very high. How can we inspire? I mean, you've connect the previous generation with the younger generation. How do we inspire the nation to not necessarily get them building, but inspire and STEM subject in school, or get young people to involve in, let's say, engineering?
I think one of the first is that is by targeting, like definitely targeting schools. So instead of just sat there in physics class and being lectured on the theory behind it, I think that you need, but the industry needs to get involved and target them people with hands-on experience. So so how if a plane, you know, they were talking about planes, how does a plane fly? And you'd need to get, or how to build this, and you need to just include a bit more hands-on process, and then definitely lead on to experiences like this, and especially with work experience as well. You know, at the end of year, I believe it's year 10, you have a two-week gap to do work experience. And to get onto this work experience for British Airways was done through the project, and that was extraordinary for me. But I think that more needs to be done in offering apprenticeships, graduate jobs, and placements as well. So my year out, I actually applied to a few aviation companies, and it's I'm not going to lie to you guys, I got declined from a few of them. I'm not sure why. Because I was expressed interest in and showed this project. But it's through that that I believe that we need to open up more opportunities like this, and that will then flood a wave of young people into applying for these and successful, which then they can then develop within this company. And I believe that's the way forward, is to offer more opportunities and better access to do this, and tell people how to get onto these such programs and target young people more from the early age through projects just like this, and that's how you do it. Personally, that's how I believe. Any other questions? This guy down the front.
Yes, the supplier of your kit, obviously not Airfix, but who were they? Once you actually got the program going? I mean, did they just say, right, you know, here's your receipt, it's come through the post, there's your kit, get on with it? Or was an actual company actually gave you backup after that?
Oh, that's quite a hard question. Ross or John? Yeah, is that okay? Sorry, I think I'm best pass this on to Ross, who would know more about that.
Headquarters. It's a RAeS aircraft kit, and that's an American company. And in the UK, there's a distributor called Skycraft. So we purchase the aircraft through Skycraft, the kit, who deal with all the customs and get it into the UK. They also supply the engine as well, which is Australian, the Jibiru. And basically, yeah, if we do need spare parts, issues arise with it, that kind of problem, we go to Skycraft in the UK. who are the only authorised agent, I think they would tell you. Thank you.
Fantastic. So just get them to fix it, basically.
Yeah, just another question. The obviously putting an aircraft together looks fairly okay, but things, simple things like tightening up nuts and bolts, there's obviously a certain amount of torque involved, because it's quite easy to actually strip nuts or put two things too tightly or not tight enough together. Again, is that in the instructions, or you actually had sort of special torque wrenches to make sure?
I would say that I've given you a brief overview of the how we built the plane, and I didn't mention all the problems that we overcome, because obviously over a four-year period, you can have more problems than I can touch on. Obviously, successes as well. But the manual was very thick, it was very detailed, and it told you how to do it. I remember, I believe, John will correct me if I'm wrong, but a few times we didn't do the rivet properly. So what we had to do is just ensure that we took it out. It was an easy process, and then we just redid it. So there was fail-safe procedures that we had to follow when it wasn't right, but that's why we had an inspector come in and inspect every part. So that's how we kind of dealt with that. But over torque tension, it's kind of just working with the supervisors, really, just to make sure that it was done properly to the correct standards. But sometimes it was a bit of hit and miss, I'm not going to lie. We had a manual that wasn't very digital, just a bit of paper. So it's kind of just hit and miss, really. But then it was inspected more thoroughly, so.
Yeah, no, thanks very much. Fantastic experience. I'm quite interested to know what it was like to fly. I mean, it doesn't look like the most robust. I'm sure it met every safety standard. So, and I guess the ultimate confidence of anybody that's built a plane is to actually fly it themselves. So I don't know, did you ever get a chance to fly it?
Do you know what? I completely forgot the whole flying part of it. It's crazy how I did. So we did get the opportunity to fly it. And that was extremely rewarding. So what it was to fly, it was amazing to fly. So I was the first to go up in the plane, one of the first students in our team. And my name was put forward in the hat, and I was pulled out first. And I went up there with John. It's incredible to fly. It really is emotional. When you take off, it's just the most emotional thing to think, actually, I bolted the fuselage onto the mainframe. And so part running through your head is, is that going to shake off? Did I do that right? Is that okay? So you're kind of there, like kind of shaking, holding the stick, like what's going to happen? But obviously it had been rigorously tested and things. But that was actually an incredible chance and experience to be able to fly this plane, and especially because you built it as well. It was really emotional. We had a few, we had a lot of tears actually on the time where people come down. Some of the students actually went up and flew it, and they came down just in tears because it meant so much to them, because it's been part of our lives for the last 4 years. You know, once you get up in the air and then come down, it suddenly hits you like we've spent thousands of hours, you know, committing and dedicated to this, and then we've just flown it. And it really was an emotional day, and the weather was beautiful, and John helped us fly it each. So that was, I keep mentioning John. That was absolutely fantastic. Oh.
Hi, just have a question about the design aspect of the aircraft. I saw some aerofoils and some students playing around with aerofoils. Did you have any aspect of the design in the project? If yes, to what extent? And if no, then do you think it would have helped?
No. So, sorry, your question was, did we have any influence on the design?
On the design, yes.
Yeah, no, we didn't really. We kind of got all these bits and boxes, and then we had a manual. So some of these, like the tubes, the aluminium tubes needed cutting down to the right size, but we didn't have any influence over the design of it. We just got a manual. I'm just making this sound really simple, but we got a manual and we followed this manual and then got the finished product. But the plane went through a rigorous selection process. So I think there was eight planes. David might correct me if I'm wrong, but there was a few planes that were up for on the shortlist, and this RAeS Coyote 2 was chosen. So obviously, and it was a fantastic choice.
Do you think if you had any aspect of aerodynamics design or any basics, would that have made it more significant or?
I'm not really sure on that question. So sorry, what your question was?
Yeah. So if you had studied some basic aerodynamics before building the plane, would you have joined the aerospace industry in a more technical manner?
I believe yes. I think it was quite a hard choice for me to know what to at such an early age. You know, the school systems makes you choose your subjects from such an early age. So I'm standing there very young, 13, 14, not knowing what the next week will bring, and they're saying, right, would you like to do science or maths? What do you like to choose? So it's quite a hard path to choose when you're younger. But I would have liked to have studied more into the STEM subjects, so that was one of my biggest regrets. However, like I said, the world is changing. I believe that we can move between industries with such flexibility that I don't really think it matters what you study, because I have experience from working with engineers that have more experience than sitting in front of a lecturer or in a classroom learning, and you can learn much more from practical experiences. So the answer is no, there's endless opportunities for me from now to move into the aviation industry, not having studied anything to do with it. So,
thank you.
Hi Ollie, my name's James. So I spend a lot of my time in my role trying to certify the smallest parts. Even a tiny little placard will take probably a week to get airworthy. So I look at that and think, how do you get that certified? How's it safe to fly?
I'm sure when this turned up at the legals desk, I'm sure if it said built by students, they probably just put it to the side and went, no, thank you, we're not touching that. However, It did take a long time to get it signed off, but there was a lot of processes in place from the Royal Aeronautical Society, and they pushed through for this to get signed off. So obviously, along the way, it had been signed off each step by the supervisors and another person, Gordon. So each step was signed off as it was being built, and then as a whole, I'm assuming, Ross will correct me if I'm wrong, this was then, the legal stuff behind it was then certified. And it was in flight. Is that correct, John? Or is that correct? John Mitchell will help explain more.
No homebuilt aircraft is certified. It flies on a permit to fly, which is issued by the CAA through the Light Aircraft Association. Fantastic. The Light Aircraft Association supervises the build. They have a whole range of supervisors. Gordon Hill was ours. And they have to sign off the build processes, the build stages, and the final tests, the whole airframe, the controls, the engine. And once that's done, it flies on a permit, so it's not certified. This is a highly successful aeroplane. It's a microlite, American kit, and there are thousands of them flying. It's very strong, very good aeroplane.
Thank you, John. Yeah, that sums it up very nicely.
Gordon, by the way, had a heart attack a little while ago.
Oh, did he? Oh, okay. No worries. Yeah, so I could talk for hours.
Hello, Petra Grattan from Brunel University, London. Thank you so much for giving us an insight into a very interesting project. And I was very interested about what you were saying about the gliding experience. And I wondered whether you'd had any more experience of flying or whether you intended to fly a bit more in the future.
I 100% intend to fly in the future. Unfortunately, I didn't, because I had quite a busy life around 2011 to 2012 and securing university places and with my sport in competitions. I didn't really take up this much after. However, this was another regret of mine because I wish that I'd done. I did, sorry. But now I think I had the opportunity to go back and relearn gliding and take up my flying certificate, and I would like to go back and explore more options in that area.
Because I was wondering whether you might consider building another aeroplane and piling it yourself.
100%. Definitely 100%.
I'll look forward to that talk.
Yeah, I'll fly you in it.
Oliver, thank you very much. I'd like to invite Jonathon Counsell, IAG's Head of Sustainability, to come and say a few words.
Thank you.
Yeah, so, good evening. It's a great pleasure for me to close this talk, and I think you agree, very fantastic presentation there from Oliver. So I'm Jonathon Counsell. I'm Group Head of Sustainability at IAG, and I'd if you allow me to say a few words about IAG at some point, because I'd like to think that there's some great opportunities for our next generation in terms of our particular organisation and UK aviation overall. But I must congratulate you, Oliver. That was a fantastic presentation, and also all those that took part. So really well done. That was very good. And a big congratulations to the Royal Aeronautical Society, Boeing, and also the Light Aircraft Association. I think this is a fantastic initiative to take aviation into our schools. It is a fantastic industry. I've been fortunate enough to work in aviation for 30 years, and it's never been a dull moment. There are so many opportunities in our particular industry. And also those important STEM subjects. We know that this country is built on science and technology and engineering, so anything we can do to encourage next generation into those STEM subjects, and I think this is a great example of that. So I spent 30 years in industry, never a dull moment. I'm an engineer, mechanical engineer by profession. I've worked on aircraft and engines. I've actually been involved in building airport terminals. In fact, one of the more interesting jobs I've had in my career was finding new homes for the British Airways Concorde fleet. So when we retired the fleet, my boss came in one day and said, "Do you want to find new homes for these 7 aircraft?" And I can tell it didn't take long to think about the answer to that question. If anyone will be around later, I can tell you lots of stories there. And now I'm involved in the environment, which again is a fantastic challenge for our industry, but again, lots of opportunity, and it is a key to securing our growth. And it is an exciting time for aviation. For the first time ever since I've been in aviation, say 30 years, we've been talking about consolidation. This is airlines joining together, not alliances, but true consolidation. This is the key to the future strength and sustainability of our industry, and we are starting to see it the last 5 years, both in the US and in Europe, and IAG is one of the leading organizations at the forefront of that. So I'd just like to say a few words about what we're doing. But I was very interested in Oliver's stats there. This is something I saw a couple of days ago, the latest stats out of IATA on the scope of the air transport industry globally. And it is mind-blowing when you look at some of those numbers. 10 million passengers a day. And someone pointed out to me that any time of night or day, there are over 10,000 aircraft flying with more than 3 million people in them. So right now, there are more than 3 million people up in the air, and that's the culmination of what our industry delivers. So let me say a little bit about IAG. So we were formed in 2011. We are the parent company of currently 4 airlines: Aer Lingus, British Airways, Iberia, and Vueling. And as I say, we are the leading edge of consolidating the industry here in Europe. And you can just see some of the numbers there. You know, we're almost up to 100 million passengers a year, 550 aircraft, and we're growing strongly. And believe me, this isn't the end of the story. We will look to continue to consolidate. And this is the key to building a sustainable industry. We also have a very good mix of where we fly. You can see there the share across the world. I see in this map here that Russia is part of Europe. We might want to rethink that definition going forward. But anyway, you can see a truly global business. And our overall mission is to be the leading airline group in the world. And we know that we will only do that by employing the best people. So we're very keen to attract the next generation into our industry. So I was very taken by some of the points there. And so we'll think long and hard about how do we get into schools to encourage people to get into this industry. Because it's very common that once people get into industry, into the aviation industry, they rarely leave. once they fully understand the opportunities and the passion and excitement that it invokes. And uniquely for airline groupings, we stick with the brands that join our business. So we build on the strength of those brands. So we don't create an umbrella brand. We stick with the Aer Lingus, the BA, the Iberia, and the Vueling brand. And I think that is one of the keys to our success and why the financial markets really like the IAG model over other examples. And this is one thing I wanted to show. I've just got a video. I saw it a few weeks ago. It's produced by NATS, and it shows 24 hours of flight over the UK. And for me, this is the culmination of what our industry delivers. Over 6,000 flights a day in the UK alone, 100,000 flights a day over the world. So I'd just like to let you have a look at this. Like me, I always get, it blows my mind when I think that happens every single day above our skies. So, and I guess that's why people have such a passion for our industry. So, congratulations again, Oliver, and I really look forward to the next generation coming along and being the future of our aviation industry. So, thank you very much for this evening, and hopefully see you again soon.
From across the globe, from the centre of aerospace, and now to you.
Thank you for downloading from the Royal Aeronautical Society. If you enjoyed this content, please consider showing your support for the Society. Share a link to this presentation by email or on your favourite social networks. If you have an interest in aerospace, consider the professional and personal benefits of membership. Visit www.aerosociety.com.